We are rolling on the new Sigma 16mm f1.4. Okay, I gotta give it props. The 16mm from Sigma is the I gotta give everybody props because I see why they like it so much. I've never had, okay, so 16mm on APS-C, which is a crop sensor camera, is equivalent to 24 on full frame. And people hype up 24 a lot. I see why now. I've never had a 24 prime. I've had zoom lenses that go to 24 and I've tried them at 24 and I didn't really notice anything special, but this, I get it now. It's like just wide enough and you get some separation. Like, look at the background right now. You can actually, it's kind of blurry. So yeah, 1 week later, I'm loving this lens for the YouTube videos. I think it's great. I want to go test it outside a little bit more. I'm sure it's going to be fine. The only problem is going to be because it lets in so much light. That might be the issue, but I'm going to try it out and see. I just want to get out and really just, I just want to play with it, to be totally honest. The photographer in me wants to actually try out 24 millimeters, even on crop sensor, because let's be honest, a lot of the time you can't even tell the difference if you're really good. So after switching to this lens, it might yet again be one of my favorite focal lengths. I may end up looking for a 24 millimeter for the full frame. Not anytime soon, because I would like to get, there's some videos I want to make that I actually need some APS-C lenses for, which I might just rent to make the videos, but that's coming in the future. So eventually though, 24 on a full frame, I'm digging it. I like this look. I like this look a lot. The 30 millimeter is definitely gonna be the next one, and then the 56 from Sigma. If you've seen the Sigma trio, it is this lens, then the 30, then the 56. And I think the 56 would be a really good one to compare to, okay, the Sigma 56 on APS-C would be a very good one to compare to 85mm f1.8 on a full frame camera. I'm gonna compare that to the Sony 85mm 1.8. I think that'd be a cool comparison, and they're both really good lenses, but I know that 56 is super sharp, so we'll just have to see how they compare. So stay tuned for that. That'll be coming in a couple weeks probably. Now Friday, one of my friends, he's just starting out in photography and he is shooting his motorcycle and cars and stuff. He's kind of just doing everything. I feel like that's what a lot of up and coming photographers, or even car photographers, like up and coming car photographers, they get into it and they really just want to shoot anything and everything just to really practice and play with the camera, you know, get that down. And I get that. And he was shooting at sunset and he was trying to expose for the background and his motorcycle. I had told him to do an HDR image and I was like, there's tons of videos on YouTube on how to do that. But I was like, well, I have never made one. Why don't I make one? I know how to do it in Lightroom, super easy. Once I found out how to do it, I was like, wow, I wish I would have known that years ago, because that would have helped me out a ton when I was shooting sunsets or sunrises, because I used to do sunrises a lot. I haven't had as much time to do sunrises anymore, but sunsets I can still do quite often. So Friday's video is how to do and how to create an HDR image, which, if you don't know what HDR means, it's high dynamic range image. And it's basically when it's hard to expose for the background and your subject at the same time, which sunset, sunrise, those times is the most difficult, especially when you're shooting a car and you have the sun behind it. Like, it's either going to be black or the background, the sky, is going to be totally white and blown out. So Friday's video, I'm going to show you exactly how to expose for both and make them look as good as possible. That's planned for Friday. Make sure you're subscribed so you don't miss that video. And I will see all of you in Friday's video. We're learning about HDR. Let's go.